Merry Christmas, Current family. We're so grateful to be with you this morning. Current is a community following Jesus together, and you're welcome wherever you are on your spiritual journey. You're probably noticing it looks a little different today. Welcome to Current HQ. If you've been to any of our drive-through events this fall, the service event a couple of weeks ago, you've been outside of our offices here in Sunnyvale, and we're so grateful to finally be recording in this space. The team has done an amazing job setting it up. Extra thank you to Miranda Hudson, one of our leaders, who popped in this week to work her magic and make it beautiful for us to celebrate Christmas together this week. If you're new here with us, we're so glad you're here. We'd love for a chance to be able to follow up with you. You can fill out whatever information you're comfortable with over at currentsv.church/connect and let us be able to tell you more about what's coming up. If you've never been to a Current welcome lunch, there is one coming up right after the new year on Sunday, January 10th. It happens right after the second worship gathering around 12:15. We do it online right now, given COVID. We do it via Zoom, but our team, amazing team, will drop you a Starboard lunch if you RSVP over at currentsv.church/welcome lunch. It's a chance for us to share more about Current, how we got started, our values as a community following Jesus together here in the Silicon Valley, and to get to know one another better. You'll meet a couple of our leaders, and we would love a chance to be able to get to know you as well. Well, we've been talking a lot about our year-end impact initiative the last couple of weeks, and we didn't want to close out 2020 without hearing an update about one of our closest partners that's familiar to many of us who've been over to serve at the shelter there over in East Palo Alto. So here to share with us today is Rose, who leads our partnership with We Hope.
I'm excited to share a bit about We Hope, an organization Current has been partnering with since summer of 2018. We Hope is a nonprofit in East Palo Alto that offers many services for the needy across the Bay Area. They have an emergency shelter program where meals are prayed over and clients have opportunities to hear the gospel. They do job training and certification, and they offer mobile services called Dignity on Wheels. Dignity on Wheels provides showers, laundry, and restrooms for homeless encampments throughout the Bay Area. Because of your generous giving, when COVID began, Current was able to respond quickly with $10,000 to help We Hope buy a mobile restroom. Public park restrooms closed when shelter-in-place started, meaning the homeless couldn't access sanitation services right when it was needed the most. We Hope has seen demand for Dignity on Wheels services double since COVID began. Many of their staff members have had to work extra long hours since their hiring couldn't keep up. Some people left home at 8 a.m. in the morning and didn't get home until midnight. To thank these staff members who are on the front lines working tirelessly daily, we got the opportunity to provide goodie bags for their annual staff appreciation party, containing snacks and Amazon gift cards. Thank you to everyone who helped put together staff appreciation gifts and customized clothing gifts for 55 homeless clients in We Hope Shelter Program during the wrapping party a few weeks ago. We look forward to more opportunities to partner with We Hope in 2021 and returning to serve at the shelter in person after COVID is over. If you'd like to help organize projects for We Hope this coming year, please feel free to let me know.
Thanks so much, Rose. We're so grateful for you and for the life-changing work happening through We Hope here in the Bay Area. We do look forward to the day when our Current groups can head back to serve together there at the shelter. All right, we've got so many fun things coming up for you today. First off, our Current Kids Choir is making their big screen debut. A huge thank you, kids and parents, for working so hard to make this virtual choir possible this year. A big thank you to Christina Slabau and Chris Kim and Casado, one of our video editors, for their work on this video. Without further ado, we present to you Current Kids Choir 2020.
The hymn of angels sing, glory Hey, great job, Current Kids. Current family, if we're not already doing so, can we just smash that heart button just to say wonderful job to the Current Kids? You guys did such a great job singing. What a wonderful, wonderful project. Thank you, guys. And a big shout out and thank you to the teams for bringing that together and to the parents for making that possible. What a special treat. Merry Christmas, everybody. We're just a couple days out now, of course, from Christmas itself. We're so glad that you could join us today to worship together in this way. Welcome, little ones, as you join us today, too, as we make this more of a family service. Well, I don't think a year ago any of us anticipated Christmas being this sort of Christmas. I mean, with all of the COVID-19 related events happening, shelter in place, we're all experiencing some degree of loss, some sense of isolation, pain, hurt, some in greater ways than others, but all of us are experiencing it in some form or fashion. And I think it's because of this that we're able to just ever so slightly more be able to relate to the actual Christmas story. Typically, this time of year, we focus on the Bible stories, the Bible texts that are related to the nativity scene, right? Jesus in the manger, and Mary, Joseph, the shepherds, and the wise men all gathering around. And typically we think of the angels in the sky singing and proclaiming God's praises and his wonderful promises. And we sing and remember things like hope, peace, and joy. And you know what? It's all there. It's all there in the Christmas story. But you know what's also there in the Christmas story? Lots of pain and hardship, confusion, even death. And I think it's important for us to understand these things, especially in a year like we're in now. And so what I want to do is read a text here that's not typically focused on during the Christmas season. And as I read it, I wonder if you'll see why we don't typically focus on it. But let's look at Matthew chapter 2, verses 13 through 23. When they, that is the wise men or magi, had gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. "Get up," he said, "take the child and his mother and escape to Egypt. Stay there until I tell you, for Herod is going to search for the child to kill him." So he got up, took the child and his mother during the night and left for Egypt, where he stayed until the death of Herod. And so it was fulfilled what the Lord had said through the prophet, "Out of Egypt I called my son." When Herod realized that he had been outwitted by the Magi, he was furious, and he gave orders to kill all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity who were 2 years old and under, in accordance with the time he had learned from the Magi. Then what was said through the prophet Jeremiah was fulfilled. "A voice is heard in Ramah, weeping in great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children and refusing to be comforted because they are no more." After Herod died, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother and go to the land of Israel, for those who are trying to take the child's life are dead." So he got up, took the child and his mother and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was reigning in Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. Having been warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee, and he went and lived in a town called Nazareth. So was fulfilled what was said through the prophets that he would be called a Nazarene. Well, clearly we can see why this text doesn't typically get the focus this time of year, right? We typically focus on hope, peace, and joy, which again are very much a part of not only the Christmas message, but the Christian message. But what we also see here in this text, of course, is a lot of pain and hardship. And it's important for us to understand, as I mentioned earlier, all the more in a year like the one we're in now. Today's message is meant to be a little bit shorter, more of a devotional thought. So while there's so much we could pull out of this text, I want to zero in on what I believe is going on here at the high level. What I see here, it seems to me, is this. God didn't just send his son into the world to save it. God sent his son into the world deliberately in such a way that we can know, like truly know, that he is with us and there for us no matter what, no matter what we face. Because the Christmas message here, and really the Christian message, is not a promise that life will become easier, that life will be made easy. In fact, for the Christian, it often means life can and will be harder. Certainly this was true for Jesus, God's own son. I mean, he was born into a manger, which of course meant that he was born into poverty. But he was immediately then, just a little while longer, thrusted into a life where he was fleeing for his life. His family were refugees. It makes me think of our wonderful ministry partners in Greece, in Athens, Michalis and Lois, who serve as missionaries there, really helping to serve Syrian refugees. I mean, the Syrian refugee crisis is still going on strong, sadly. I mean, it's now been going for over 10 years, and there have been now more than 5.5 million Syrian refugees fleeing for their lives. I mean, it's just terrible and sad. And you know the stories of parents or people just going to great lengths and at great cost and risk to themselves in order to flee and get out. Well, most of them have been going through Athens, and that's why Michalis and Lois have been able to serve there and thankfully been able to partner with them. But the point is, that's a scary life. That's a hard life. That's a life like the one our Lord wrote himself into. And you know, that's what really sticks out to me as we read this text. Matthew, the writer of this gospel account, not only tells us that this is how it played out, but he deliberately takes the time to say, and this is how the prophets foretold it would happen, right? There's any number of times, at least about three here, where he quotes a prophet. He says that the prophet Micah says that this is why he would be called out of Egypt, that Jesus would be known as coming out of Egypt. And then he quotes Jeremiah saying this is why he was foreknown to be born into brokenness and great weeping. And then there's also that reference of he'll be known as a Nazarene. It's like God is saying, hey, this isn't just happened by chance. I deliberately planned it this way for great reason. Well, what does this mean for us? Little ones, current kids, as you guys are on, let me ask you a question, and you can even share your answer with your parents. When you think of God, where he is and what he's doing, what comes to mind? When you think of God, what comes to mind as to what he's doing and where he is? When I was a little guy, elementary school age, I would have answered, you know, he's sitting up in a throne somewhere in heaven, just way up there, and, you know, angels are around him. And, you know, the Bible speaks to that. We're given that picture that God is in heaven and he is on his throne. But you know what another picture God gives us about who he is and what he came to do? He was born into our world. He took on flesh and blood. He became a human being and was born as a person into this world, but not just into any story. I mean, if you were to write yourself into a story, wouldn't you write yourself into the story to become like a prince or princess so that you could one day become the king or queen? Jesus was written into a story where he was immediately, his family, fleeing for their lives. That was a scary thing to live through. And God deliberately did it in that way to help us know that he really, truly understands, you know, wherever we're at and whatever we're facing. I use this example in the past to describe how we ought to be there for others. But to consider this thought in light of this is who God is and what he does for us is just kind of mind-boggling. But there's something too when people come to us and help us when we're facing hard things and they have themselves gone through hard things. A few years back, I went through some really hard times. I don't necessarily look it, but I developed an autoimmune condition, a rare form of arthritis, and was getting to the place where I could hardly stand. And then it was also at the time where there was a lot of life pressures and stresses to the point I was experiencing heart palpitations and just extreme weight loss in a short periods of time. Just, I don't want to overdo it here, but just I was just in a hard place, just, you know, just really stressed and not knowing what to do or how to face it all. Well, I had a number of people come to me in that season of my life, which I'm so grateful for, who basically said, hey, we're with you and we love you and it's going to be okay. And I'm so grateful for the folks in our lives who say such things and are there for us in such ways. But then there were also people who came to me and came alongside me in very much a similar way, using almost the same exact words, but from a place of having they themselves gone through a lot of hardship and pain. And even though they used the same words, more or less, it was completely different in terms of how they were ministering to me, speaking into my life, and helping encourage and lift me up. We need both. We need people saying that no matter what, we need people who also really can understand, empathize, truly like sit in with us because they've experienced this. This is what this means. God, who sits on his throne, doesn't just know about our situation, our hardship, and our pain, just on some like abstract level, just kind of in a, yeah, I could see how that'd be hard type way. No, he truly understands to his very core because he faced everything we faced and so much harder, so much more painful things. Because the Christmas story, yeah, he was born into a refugee home, fleeing for their lives. Which, incidentally, we probably should just say here real quickly, is something far greater and scarier than probably any of us face, even here in 2020, as hard of a year as some of you have faced. I mean, that's a scary situation. But even as scary as that was, it didn't compare to what he ultimately came to do, and that is go to the cross, where he experienced infinitely greater pain and hardship on our behalf, because on the cross, he took all the pain, all the hardship, all the injustice, all the sin that we caused and others caused to us, all of the pain and hurts on his body to offer forgiveness that we could receive a restored relationship with him. He experienced not just being a refugee, on the cross, he experienced being isolated, his relationship severed with his eternal Father for the sake of loving you and me. Not just to save us, but to do it in such a way that he understands us to the infinite degree, whatever we face, so that he's with us and always there for us. Which means, friends, as we celebrate Christmas this year, let's remember the joy, the hope, the peace that's available to us. Like, let's sing it even today as we continue the service. That's what Christmas is about. That's what the Christian message is about. At the same time, let us also remember the one, that same baby, our Lord, who came into this world having left his heavenly throne in order to express his love in such a way to know, to help us know, truly know, that he can be with us in and through anything and everything. Let's pray. Father, we do not deserve your love. Jesus, we do not deserve your coming into this world, let alone in such a way that you can know us fully and make your love fully known to us. We give you praise and we give you thanks. May this Christmas, yes, even here at the end of 2020, be a joyous occasion for each and every one of us, as we remember truly the greatest gift of all, your love made available to us. And would you help us hold out that same love to those around us in our lives? We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, before I pass things over to continue this time in worship, I wanted to hype our end of year impact campaign. We're calling Impact 2021. Which we get really excited about this time of year, because ever since, you know, our first few months as a church 4 years ago on this, that first Christmas season, we decided we wanted to start the way we wanted to go forward. And even though then we were especially externally funded and helped by other churches, we thought, you know what, we still want to raise an impact fund to augment what we're doing in the community. And so that first year, we set a goal of raising $10,000. I think $8,700 came in that first year, and we were thrilled. We were ecstatic to be able to give that away and be able to use it to partner with some different organizations and ministries. Well, speed forward to last year, and last year, our impact, we set a goal of raising $50,000, and Current Family, through you, God brought in a little over $80,000, which we just give praise to God for, because that just allowed us to give in such incredible ways that we've been highlighting the last few weeks. And I just want to say, I'm excited to see what the Lord is getting ready to do this year as he chooses to lead. This year, because it's 2020, just a unique year, we decided to change the goal from a number or amount goal to participation goal. We really want the goal to be something that all of us, even those of us who've been hit especially hard from this hard year, can, you know, really kind of lock arms together and make a difference together. So our goal this year is 100% participation from those who call Current their home church. Of course, no pressure, no guilt. The whole point here is 100% of what comes in through this fund will go to augment what we are already doing in the community and really around the world, even as I mentioned, home spot in Greece earlier in the message. But I wanted to share one thought with you just to share what I'm especially excited, perhaps, as the Lord leads you and our Current family to give this year. My hope and prayer is that we would raise about or even exceed what we raised last year. Because what that would allow us to do is take what I like to think of as the next step in some of our ministry partnerships. To give you a bit of an illustration, Jim Collins, in his book, Good to Great, talks about how you can shoot bullets and you can shoot cannonballs. Well, in the earliest of days, and really up to this point, as a church, we've been with our resources shooting bullets, right? As the Lord brings in resources, we want to be generous and steward and just give away in different low amounts to try to see what works. What's effective? What relationship begins to develop and blossom? And so we've been doing that. Well, if we happen to raise about what we did last year or maybe even more, which would be really fun, we could begin to start shooting cannonballs, if you will. And that is to say, with a couple of our really key partnerships that we have now spent years developing, not only in terms of sending resources, but also in terms of coming around, in terms of volunteer hours and blessing the relationship in different ways, that would allow us to give in more substantial ways. Now, I use this all loosely because the Lord can use just a little bit. All he needs is fish and loaves to do incredible things and multiply it. But I think you know what I'm saying. So, for example, when we first were getting going here at Current, we had a number of churches who were like us the last few years, who believed in us as a church plant and saw church planting as something that was really important that they wanted to invest in. And so, you know, from humble places that they were in, they said, hey, we want to give you a gift of a one-time gift of $2,000 or $5,000. And when churches gave that, we were ecstatic. We were thrilled. And we thanked them and we thanked the Lord for them. But then there were also some churches that came alongside us and said, hey, we believe in what you're doing, and we believe in what God does through church planting, especially in the Bay Area, and we want to come alongside you for the period of 3 years for this amount, a significantly higher amount. And I'll tell you, that enabled us as a church to plan in different ways, to think about ministry in different ways. This is not to say one's better than the other, but it's to say I think we're moving into the place of whether it's with a church plant, whether it's with some of our key ministry partners or the organizations in the community, or wherever it might be, we might have an opportunity to kind of shoot cannonballs, to continue to borrow from Jim Collins, in such a way where we can give in even greater measures. And so, no pressure here. This is obviously meant to be no, you know, guilt or anything like that. Again, 100% of this goes to augment what we're already doing in the community anyways. But wouldn't it be fun to be able to increasingly give in increasing measure and have greater impact, all for God's glory? Because by God's grace, we live in an area that is, for the most part, has been insulated from a lot of the effects of COVID-19. How awesome would it be if we as a church could lead out in generosity in helping those who've been most impacted by it? So would you prayerfully consider giving above and beyond your regular giving to Current in order to help us make an increasing impact in the community and beyond? It would just be fun to celebrate this with you in the new year as we get to continue to give away what the Lord brings in. Thank you guys for considering this, and we're excited to do this with you because really the point of this is we can do more together than we could do alone. All right, well, we're going to now continue our Christmas worship together, and I want to introduce to you very special guests who are going to take this next set and lead this next step for us, the Heart Family. Some of you will remember them. Matt was stationed here for a number of years, helped the church get up and running, and as it was posted elsewhere, so they sadly had to leave the area, but they are going to be leading us virtually here, their whole family, so let me excitedly pass things over to the Hearts now.
Hi, Current.
Hi.
Heart family up from Fairfield. Miss you guys. Been
miss
a while.
You.
Love to see some songs with y'all.
One, two, three, four. Thank you.
Love y'all.
Love you.
So fun. Thanks so much, Heart family. Love singing those Christmas carols together. Let's continue our worship with the offering now. This is a time each week when we come to God with our resources, expressing that we trust His provision and that we want to join Him in life-changing work. You heard about Impact 2020, our year-end initiative, from both Rose and David already today. It's an opportunity for us to trust God together as a community to do more through Current here in our community, in the Bay Area, and globally in 2021. You can join in by giving at currentsv.church/impact2020 or by pressing that button in the live chat. You can also give via stock donation by emailing stockdonations@currentsv.church. We have so much to look forward to. We are excited to share with you, Current family, that we have signed a contract with the Hyatt Centric in Mountain View as our facility for Sundays in 2021. The city let us know earlier this fall that they wouldn't be opening up buildings for rental anytime soon, either inside or outside. So we started to look at backup options to see if we could find an outdoor space. The Hyatt has a beautiful outdoor patio that's connected to their indoor ballroom. It's very well ventilated that we can move into as soon as it makes sense. And so we hope to start hosting digital outdoor worship gatherings sometime in Q1, meaning outdoor in-person gatherings as we live stream online. We're very aware of the COVID situation around us and we will be watching it carefully, but we also want to be ready with a plan that we can execute as soon as it makes sense. So as we celebrate Christmas together today and look ahead to 2021, know that there is a plan in place and you'll be hearing more about it as we come back together in the new year. Before we wrap up today, we have one more fun Christmas surprise for you. Current is very grateful to be part of Transforming the Bay with Christ, an interdenominational organization of gospel-believing churches here in the Bay Area. Together with 64 other churches, TBC put together a Christmas blessing this year that we were excited to send our team to be a part of. This amazing expression of unity and hope. A huge thanks to TBC for supporting this project and for the opportunity to participate. See if you can find some familiar faces repping Current. Enjoy.
Christ the Savior is born.
So beautiful. Love it so much. Thanks for repping Current, Chris and Allie. A couple more announcements before we wrap up today. As is our tradition, we take the Sunday after Christmas off to give all of our teams time for rest and to draw a breath before the new year. Worship will not happen at set times on Sunday, December 27th. It will be sent out via an email, and you can worship when makes sense for you. And then we'll be back all together again as usual on Sunday, January 3rd. Merry Christmas, Happy New Year. We love you, Current family. Go in peace.
and the Lord of my soul, King of my heart, Jesus, it's you. Yes, it is.